An awesome day. We're excited to have Dustin Sandoval with us from Feet That Move. And when you came in and you saw our, did you see our new missions wall on the left? If you didn't see it, ask the Lord to heal your eyes. Dave Fulbright spent hours up here helping us get that done, and then Riley put the finishing touches on it, and it looks awesome. She did an outstanding job. In fact, this is something she and I have been talking about for months, and we just finally said, okay, we got to get this done. And so we wanted to get it done this week. And so if you saw out in the foyer, there's a little setup for Dustin's ministry, Feet That Move, and those shoes. Those are not Crocs. They look like Crocs. Croc actually stole the idea from Dustin. No, I don't know if that's true or not. Mark that off the video. I didn't say that. No copyright infringement or anything like that. No, but those are the shoes they give away in their ministry opportunities. And so this morning, we've asked Dustin to come and share not only about Feet That Move, but he's going to take opportunity this morning to preach and share what the Lord's put on his heart for us today. But before we do that, we have about a 3-minute video just to kind of give you a picture of what's going on with them. And then Dustin's going to come and just share today. Amen. Thank you, worship team.
Look how far we've come. Look where we started from. Best thing about it is, you know, we've only just begun. They say life's a dance, 10% circumstance, but what great adventure ever plays out just the way you planned. We'll fly into the turbulence, no telling where we're gonna land. Isn't that just part of this romance? So when I'm stuck out in the cold, too much to hold, let me be lighthearted.
Can we give Dustin a big destiny welcome this morning? Come on, Dustin. Amen.
Good morning. How are y'all? Y'all doing well this morning? So I live in Mexico, and I haven't used the word y'all in about 9 months. And so I'm happy to be back here in Texas where I can speak my first language, which is English. I just want to start off and just say an incredibly, I'm so, so privileged and honored to be here this morning. Pastor Scott, Pastor Tiffany, Riley, the entire Russell family, thank you for giving me this incredible opportunity to share with this incredible church. It's been amazing worshiping together this morning. I just want to thank you. I've been praying for your church for about 3.5-4 months now, knowing that I was going to be coming back in September and knowing that I was going to be able to just share just a little bit about our ministry, Feet That Move, as well as just a message that the Lord's laid on my heart. But I really, truly do feel that we're family. I want to thank you for even sowing into Riley as she came and got to serve exactly where this video was taken. That was another group that came in 2016. But I just want to personally thank you for not only financially giving towards Riley, but as well as just your prayers and your support and your encouragement from afar. I know that Riley was so blessed to have the backing of this incredible family here at Destiny Center. And it was an incredible privilege to be able to serve alongside Riley, and just who she is as a woman of God and just the gifts that she brought to our team was really, really special. My sister Bailey and my friend Haley are on that trip as well, and they're here this morning. But it was an incredible trip. I just want to share just a quick second about what we do in Mexico, and then I'm just going to kind of jump into the Word and share what the Lord has put on my heart. But this was taken in the Yucatan Peninsula, this video, and our ministry has been around since 2013. We've had the privilege of traveling to Uganda and Haiti and El Salvador and Laos and Thailand and Nepal and many different places, just being salt and light in the earth and sharing the love of God everywhere we've gone. And our shoes are just an entry into a community. And so we go into a community, we prayer walk in a community, and we go into a community and we wash the feet of those that are in each and every community. And over the last 3 or 4 years, we've seen about 3,500 people come to know Jesus through our outreaches with local church partnerships in different indigenous areas around the world. We've given about 6,000 pairs of shoes, and so it's pretty awesome when God gives you a strategy and a model that's not your own. And it's amazing to see that every one and every two people has come to know Jesus, which is just an incredible privilege to be a part of for myself and our entire team. It's just been an incredible adventure over the last 3 or 4 years. But last summer, the Lord broke my heart for the Yucatan state of Mexico. We were working with the Mayan people. That was my very first mission trip in 2013 to this very place in the Yucatan, and my heart is totally broken for the Mayan people. And a lot of stuff happened last year that God just made an incredible way, spoke to me last September to leave everything and move and leave my family. I'm from here in Keller, right here down the road, and leave my friends, my family, and everyone else, and sacrifice my life and sacrifice my time and my gifts and my resources to these people. And for that, I'm extremely, extremely privileged. I will say it has been an incredibly difficult time down there at times, just learning a new language and different things. And so this message that I'm going to share with you this morning is out of that place. It's out of a place of personal journey with the Lord. And so I'm going to kind of jump around a little bit throughout the scriptures today. Our main passage we're going to be in is Isaiah 43. So if you have your Bibles, if you want to just go ahead and turn to Isaiah 43, we'll be in there and here in just a second. But I want to talk. I had the privilege of spending some time with Pastor Scott yesterday and Riley, and he was just explaining that y'all's mission and y'all's vision is this begin, belong, become, and go beyond. And so I'm here today, kind of filling this. It really was awesome that the message that the Lord put on my heart really fit into this going beyond. And so if you're taking notes this morning, you can write down my title is Provision in the Desert. Provision in the desert, or provision in the process, or another way, and I noticed this morning, provision for your destiny. And I really believe that God really connected those dots just right in the middle of worship. The Lord was like, wow, it's incredible. The church is called Destiny Center. It's incredible. So provision for your destiny. Now, when I was a little kid, I was always an entrepreneur, and I would walk around my neighborhood, and I would go into the yard and pick up acorns and pine cones and rocks, and I would go knock on people's doors, 5 years old, and I would say, hey, I have this incredibly beautiful rock. And because I saw a vision, I knew that I could use the five-year-old cute factor and make a few dollars to be able to, you know, pay for what five-year-olds pay for. I don't know what five-year-olds pay for. But you see, I had a vision in mind. And now, at 5 years old, it might have been selfish. It was about me. But I really believe that God, and Hebrews 12, it says, God is the author and the finisher. And so a lot of times he gives us vision for the future. Now, our purpose, our destiny, I really, truly believe, is a lost and dying world that doesn't know him. We have been blessed to come into a relationship with Jesus. And some of you might have been walking with God for 20 years, or it might be that you just came into a relationship with Jesus a couple months ago, a couple years ago. But I really, truly believe that our destiny is people. Is people. And so I love what Mark 12, 30 and 31 says. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So we see that this is our calling as the body of Christ. It's love God and it's love people. And I know that not only for myself, but for many of you, we've, as believers, this is our identity. This is who we're called to be. We're called to be salt and light in the earth. We're called to be love to a lost and dying world. But many times I know in my personal journey when God spoke to me and said, Dustin, I want you to give up your comforts of your house here and the comforts of your life here, and I want you to go. And so the moment I stepped into Mexico, I stepped into a desert. A desert where God started doing incredibly difficult heart surgery on me with personal things and different moments of seeing where I had expectations and seeing where I was broken and seeing that God was going to use a broken vessel like me to share the love that he's given me. And so if you have the passage, Isaiah 43, we're just going to read through Isaiah real quick. It's starting with this is what God says. The God who builds a road right through the ocean, who carves a path through the pounding waves, the God who summons horses and chariots and armies. They lie down and they can't get up. They're sniffed out like so many candles. Forget about what's happened. Don't keep going on over old history. Be alert, be present. I am about to do a brand new thing. It's bursting out. Don't you see it? There it is. I'm making a road through the desert, rivers in the Badlands. Wild animals will say thank you. The coyotes and the buzzards, because I have provided water in the deserts, rivers through the sun-baked earth, drinking water for the people I chose, the people I made especially for myself, a people custom-made to praise me. I love this picture of what God's doing in the desert. He's making a way where there seems no way, and it's all for a people lost and dying. So we can come into a right relationship to praise our Father in heaven. I was reading through this, and I've read through this passage 100 times. This is one of my favorite passages in Scripture, and I noticed something. It's this very first part in the passage. It says, the God who builds a road right through the ocean. Now, I'm reminded of Moses and the parting of the Red Sea, and I was thinking to myself, God, why would you show us the miracle and then send us into the desert. You show us the miracle, and then you say how you're going to make a way in the desert. And I just started to pray and think. I was like, Holy Spirit, what are you saying in this? And he said, Dustin, I believe that our my children need to know my character and know my nature before they walk into a desert season, so they have a foundation to stand off of before I'm going to make a way in the desert. The other thing that I know, even in my personal life in Mexico, that also stuck out to me in this passage was that God has encouraged us to listen and to become a son or a daughter. And he's doing a new thing in the desert. He's doing a new thing in the process. But I know for me, in the passage in Isaiah, it says, forget about what's happened. Don't keep going on over old history. When I moved to Mexico, I thought, man, I'm going to start speaking Spanish in the first week. I'm ready to start preaching in Spanish. I'm ready to start planting churches. We're going to be doing outreaches. And the Lord said, this is much more about my son than it is about ministry and numbers and trying to, you know, produce results. None of that will take place unless you become a son. And for the first time in my entire life, of my 26 years, I became a son. And the Lord started to show me things in the process in Mexico of not going through old history, not going through old patterns of thought, but he was doing a new thing in the middle of the desert. And so I have 7 different points that I want to talk about today, and these are all what I feel like are different types of provision. The first one is finances. Now, I want to start with finances because I think most people think when we're talking provision, we're talking finances. I want to start with finances, and then I want to walk through 7 other different types of provision that I believe God has for us as the body of Christ. A couple years ago, we were getting ready to go to Uganda, and we were short about $15,000 15 days before the trip. Now, that is the entrepreneur, 5-year-old kid who thinks through logistics and business and different things like this. I was stressed out. But I knew that God had called these young people to go to Uganda to share the gospel of Jesus Christ in these villages. And so we just began to pray as a family, as a team. God, you're going to have to provide. You're going to have to provide. You're going to have to provide. We're contending for these finances, not because we're awesome, but we know that you've called us to share with a lost and dying world, this community that does not know you. And so we started interceding for 15 days. And over the next 15 days, $1,000 came into our bank account every single day. Why? Because there was a people waiting to hear the message that we have been given. So I believe this is the first provision. The second provision I think is something, and if you're taking notes, you can write down, seeing God in you. Seeing God in you. Now, faith is such a journey. But I think until we get stretched, we don't see what we're made out of until we're stretched. A couple years ago, and I'm going to be sharing a lot of stories this morning because this is, in Mexico, we share stories and we share just because people can relate to a story. So I'm going to be sharing a lot of just personal experience and different stories through these different points. But number two is seeing God in you. And I went to Liberty University in Lynchburg, Virginia. I don't know if you're familiar with Liberty University, but it's the largest Christian university in the world. And there's about 100,000 students online and on campus. And I was in my freshman evangelism class where my teacher shared this incredible story that's changed my life forever. He, 2008, 2009, gave a $1 bill to a young man named John, 18 years old, freshman at Liberty University in the evangelism class. Now, evangelism is required at our school. There's about 600 in every single class, and there's many evangelism classes. So our professor, Dr. Wheeler, gave this man, this young boy named John, a dollar bill and said, I want you to use this dollar bill as a way of sharing the love of Christ somewhere here in the city. And John was getting ready. It was March. He was getting ready to go on a college spring break trip with his friends who, like any college student, was probably doing things that they probably shouldn't have been doing. But John had a different mentality. John just talked to his professor about sharing the love of God. And so he said, man, I've got a dollar bill. This is just a tool that I can use to share the love of Jesus. And so John opened his heart to what God had for him in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And they went to Fort Lauderdale and he was at a baseball game. And John was standing in line waiting to order a hot dog and some nachos. And there was a lady with three little kids standing behind him. The Holy Spirit spoke to John and said, John, I want you to buy this woman's meal. And so John, excited to share the love of God with this woman, says, ma'am, can I buy, you know, some hot dogs and some nachos and some Cokes for your family? I just want you to know how much Jesus loves you. You are so special. God loves you so, so much. And the lady with this big smile, oh my goodness, thank you so incredibly much for doing this. My kids are involved with children's church at our local church, and we've been following Jesus for the last 5 or 6 years now, and thank you so much. What a blessing that you are today. Well, this didn't really sit over well with John. He's like, God, why did you make me share the love of, this isn't, they know you already. Well, not 2 minutes later, a man comes walking up to John and with just red in the face and really, really angry. And he said, why did you just buy my wife and my kids' meal? John, 18 years old, said, sir, God has changed my life. Jesus has changed my life forever. And I had to, it's an overflowing me to share the love of God everywhere I go. Do you know what it means to have a relationship with Jesus? No, I don't want to know anything about Jesus. My kids are involved with church. My wife's involved with church. I don't want anything to do with this. 18-year-old John says, sir, here's my name. Here's my number. With boldness, not out of a, 18 years old. Here's my name. Here's my number. If you want to talk about this, you can give me a call. 2 days later, this man picks up the phone, calls John and says, John, I want you to come to my house. Now, why in the world John decides to go to this guy's house? Because if it were me, I would be going back to Lynchburg, back to my dorm, and have him a safe life. But John had other plans. He said, yes, sir, I would love to talk to you. So he drives in his rental car, and they go down. He brings a friend with him just in case, you know, got the concealed carry, you know. I know we're in Texas right now, so... He shows up to this man's house, and it is in a beautiful mansion in Fort Lauderdale. John walks into the house, shares the gospel with this man. This man gives his life to Christ. 2 years later, he gets a phone call from this same guy, and he says, John, I don't know if I told you this, but I'm a contractor, I'm a builder. I build homes in the Fort Lauderdale area. I've been very successful, it's been a huge blessing, but I want you to know that your faith and your obedience to share the love of God with my family has changed my life. But it hasn't only changed my life, it's changing our city. You see, I'm now buying homes, putting godly women from our church in these homes to disciple and mentor girls that either A, are about to go through an abortion, deciding to go through an abortion, or A, have gone through an abortion and are mourning over the loss of a baby. All because you decided to come share the love of God with my family. So my teacher, Dr. Wheeler, shares this story in the middle of evangelism, and all these, I'm 18, 19, 20 years old, and we're sitting there going, wow, this is an amazing story. Incredible. Praise God for John. Amazing. Like, what a great testimony. Well, my teacher pulls out a stack of $1 bills, and he looks at the class of 600, and he says, who's next? Now you see, evangelism class was just a regular Monday night occurrence in my life. It was a 3-hour class. I'd be on Facebook and Instagram, and the Lord spoke to me and said, Dustin, you have a decision to make. You can either come to this class and just let it be a regular Monday night, or you can let this testimony and the story change your life forever. So I prayed for a second. I said, well, I guess I'll let it change my life. So I get out of my chair, I walk down, grab my $1 bill. I'm like, wow, okay, what now, God? It was February 13th. I was dating a girl at the time in college, and like any other good boyfriend in college, the next day is Valentine's Day. So you're going to buy chocolate, you're going to buy roses, and you're going to, you know, write a romantic card, and you're going to go give it to her. So that's what I did. I got in my car the next day, February the 14th, and I started driving downtown Lynchburg, where my girlfriend at the time was teaching at an inner city school. And I, out of the corner of my eye, I see a woman standing on the side of the road. And she has a sign, and her head's down, and it says, "I'm humbled to be out here, anything can help." Well, this love overtook me in my car. I was like, oh my goodness, I gotta go talk to her. I didn't even think twice about it. I just parked the car and I ran at her. And she starts kind of backing up a little bit. "Hi, my name's Dustin. I go to Liberty University. I love Jesus. I don't know what your story is, but I need to help you. I don't know what happened, but can you tell me what happened? Because I know God loves you so much and I just have so much love for you. I don't know. It's just really weird." I just start rambling. She looks at me like I'm a crazy person. And I said, "Can you tell me your story?" And she said, "Yes, my name's Laura. I was in a car accident a couple months ago. I haven't had work. I'm a single woman. I live in a rundown apartment here in the city. And if I don't pay $150, I'm going to lose my house tomorrow. And I'm really scared." She said, "I've been out here for 4 hours and two people have given me $2. Well, this infuriated me. I said, "How in the world am I going to the largest Christian university in the world? Hundreds of people have driven by her and not one person has given her, done anything. Well, I didn't have any money, but I knew God would provide." And so out of nowhere, I don't know where the faith came from, but I literally looked at her and I said, "Ma'am, Laura, I promise you tomorrow God's going to provide every bit of the money for you." Shook her hand. "Here's my name." John gave a name and number. "So here's my name. Here's my number." Got back in my car. God, what did I just do? Oh my goodness, what did I just do? I just promised a random lady on the side of the road $150 that I don't have because I'm a poor college student. So I went back to my house. I called my parents, and like any good son would do, I said, "Mom, Dad, would you give me $150 to bless the lady on the side of the road?" And they said, "No, Dustin, we're not going to give you anything because God's going to provide for that woman." So I started praying, "God, how are we, I know that you're going to provide, but I don't know how you're going to provide." So I'm thinking like lemonade stand, go grab acorns and rocks again and go sell them at people's houses. I called my professor and I said, "Dr. Wheeler, I heard this story yesterday in your class and, you know, I had a decision to make. I can either pick up my $1 bill, let that story change my life forever, or not do anything." So I decided to walk down, grab my $1 bill, and pray, "God, use my life." "Dustin, this is incredible. I'm so proud of you. You're so awesome. Like, I cannot wait to see what God's going to do. Would you come speak to my 1250 class tomorrow?" Excuse me? "Your 1250 class. You see, Dr. Wheeler, I'm 20 years old. I've never spoken in front of a group of people. I have dyslexia. I struggled through school my entire life. I'm struggling in your class because it's hard. It's evangelism, but it's still difficult. I'm not a pastor or a preacher. I've never spoken in front of anyone. I'm not going to do that. Can't do it. I'm sorry. Like, can you give me $150? He goes, "Dustin, no, I'm not going to give you $150. Come to my 1250 class." And he said something that changed my life forever. He said, "Dustin, just share your heart and let the Holy Spirit do the rest." So I said, "Okay, I can do that." So I showed up. I spilt my coffee at lunch before I walked into the class. I was like so nervous. And I grabbed the microphone. I was shaking. Grabbed the microphone and it just went peaceful in my heart, my spirit. And I looked at the class and I said, as we sit here and we hear stories of evangelism and what God can do through our life, there are people out there dying and going to hell because we don't have enough love in our heart to share the love of God with them. I just met a lady yesterday who doesn't know Jesus and she's broken and she's hurting and she's going to lose her house. And I said, we have to help her. And that day, that class raised $550. That afternoon, I got to go walk, call Laura and say, there's a group of students that love you. And God, it wasn't me that provided for you. God provided for you. And we want you to know how much God loves you. But it wasn't until I was stretched to see what I had inside of me. So many times we're in a season, or we're in a bind, we're in a financial crisis, but until God starts stretching our faith, we don't see what we have made inside of us. You have more inside of you, and more in your spirit, and you have more faith than you realize. You see, because all we have to do is we just stay plugged into the life source of Jesus. God empowers us. Number three is signs and wonders and visions. And I love Acts 2:17. It says, in the last days, God will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. I believe that visions, signs, and wonders are a provision in the desert, in the process, for our destiny, with souls and people in mind. I was at a conference in Merida a couple months ago with the Assemblies of God, and there were pastors and leaders from all over the Yucatan state, and a friend literally just invited me the morning of the conference. Hey, I think you need to be here for this. Okay. So I went. And at the end of the night, they did an altar call for prayer for the Yucatan, for the Mayan people. Okay. Well, I wasn't really understanding Spanish at the time, so I needed God to speak to me in another way. So I sit down on my knees, and I just start praying with all these people, and I see these words, Chalem, C-H-E-L-E-M. I'm like, what in the world is Chalem? But I said, God, I know that you're speaking to me, and that was a vision, and so this is an invitation for me to press into your Holy Spirit, press into your word, and ask you for what this means, because this is not a normal occurrence for me. This is really weird. This is interesting. So I started to pray for Chalem, knowing that it might be a place. A month later, I have a friend right here from Keller who has a ministry in the Yucatan, and they invited our ministry to partner with them for a trip just to kind of get to know each other and see what how we can potentially work together. And I was so excited to go on this trip. I show up on the trip first night. I go, hey, where are we going to be doing outreach tonight? And she goes, oh, it's a little beach community right down the road. It's called Chalem. Excuse me? Chalem? Yeah, it's Chalem. I lost it. I got so emotional to think that God gave a provision in my desert. Not for me, but for a people. A church that is expanding the gospel in this little community of Chalem and planting churches. And it was an invitation. And so as God in these last days pours out his spirit on us, as he pours out his spirit, as you guys just press into the Lord here, even here in Hazlett, Texas, God's going to speak to some of you in visions and dreams. Now this is not to puff you up. This is God speaking to you. It's an invitation for a lost and dying world that is right here in our own backyard. The fourth provision, I believe, is a full capacity to go beyond what we can expect. In Daniel 1:17 it says, to these four men, God gave knowledge, understanding, kinds of literature, and learning. And Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. When I moved to Mexico, I knew zero Spanish. Zero. Nothing. Burrito, taco, because I'm from Texas and we like our Tex-Mex here. That's all. But the Lord spoke to me last summer and he said, Dustin, if you worship me in Spanish, I'll give you the language. And so for 8 months in my car, I looked like a fool worshiping Jesus in Spanish, and I started to train my tongue and my mouth to speak Spanish. Well, not in the first 3 weeks, I get invited in to the senior pastor's office of my church, and he says, I want to hear about what God's doing in the Yucatan through your ministry. I'm like, oh, that's awesome. That's great. Well, I don't speak Spanish. This is going to be real fun. I sit down in a chair, and the Holy Spirit just starts giving me words of vision to cast vision with a pastor that speaks very little English. And I felt the Holy Spirit give me words that I didn't even know why because there's a people out there. And so for some of you, there's some things that you've been called to, whether it's a business, whether you've been called to be a missionary one day, but God has things waiting for you, skill sets, tool sets that you don't even have right now that he's going to give to you. But until we fall in love with a lost and dying world, he's not going to give us this skill set to be able to share it. What happened? I went to Mexico and I fell in love with the Mayans. And I said, God, like, I can't speak the language, but you're going to have to give it to me. This is impossible for me. I have dyslexia. I struggled through school. You're going to have to give me this language. And he has. In the last 6 months, I've been able to start speaking Spanish. And it has been an incredibly humbling experience. Not, oh, I speak Spanish now. No. Because I fell in love with a people. And it was a skill set that was waiting for me. And so I don't know where you're at in maybe business or accounting or whatever, but or you're in high school or college or deciding where to go to school. There are skill sets waiting to just be deposited into your life, just like Daniel. The fifth provision is, I believe, is influence and favor. Now, a lot of people have opinions, oh man, like favor, influence. But I'm reminded of Matthew 5:14, where it says, we are a city on a hill. We are not to be hidden. Influence is not for us. Influence is for our King. And we have to reshape our theology of influence and favor. This is something that I've had to do since I've been in Mexico, because the Lord has opened doors at my church of favor, and I've struggled going, God, I don't want this to be about me. I don't want the favor. I don't want influence. And God's been reshaping my mind of this. And Dustin, there's a people waiting. Unless I raise people up in their different areas, whether it's government or whether it's you as a teacher or wherever it might be, he's got to raise us up. He can't hide us. We have too much inside of us to be able to shine for the world around us. I love what Mark Batterson says in The Circle Maker. He says, if you pray small prayers, it's offensive to Jesus. God, forgive me, forgive us for these little token prayers that we put more faith in ourselves than we do what you've done in our lives and what you did, your sacrifice on the cross. God, give us favor. God, I pray for this church. I pray that God gives you favor in this city. I pray that God gives you favor with the city of Fort Worth as you build this building. Why? Because there are people right here in your own backyard that are lost and they're dying and they're hurting. They're going through divorces. They're going through financial crisis. And what? You have the answer. The sixth provision I see that we can find in the desert is through relationships. A couple years ago, I had one of our board members who owns about 80 Domino's pizza stores at my house. He had just accepted Christ, and I felt the Holy Spirit say, you need to ask him to be on your board and help you set up, you know, everything financially and different things like this. I was like, okay. So I sit him down at the table, and I say, hey, can you help me start our ministry? He goes, no, I'm a pizza guy. I don't know what ministry is or missions. That's really awesome that God's doing that in your life, but I'm a new believer. I don't know if God can use my life. And well, a week earlier, I had written on a piece of paper the Jesus Film Project. And I had never been overseas before. I didn't know who we were going to work with overseas. But I watched a YouTube video of the Jesus film, and it broke my heart watching this simple tool of the Gospel of Luke in a video format in 1,400 languages transform the lives of people all across the world. And I said, God, this is the organization I want to work with. And so I wrote on a piece of paper, the Nationals show the Jesus film. I put my hand on the paper, 21 years old, and said, God, open a door. Open the door. So I'm sitting at this table with my friend, and he goes, You know, I can't help you, but I know this guy. He's from Argyle, and he works for an incredible organization. I think it's like a ministry or something. You know, he didn't have his Christianese all, you know, figured out and stuff. I think it's a religious organization. It's in Florida. They're called the Jesus Film Project. Excuse me? My mom laughed at me because my face turned pale white and I just began to cry. God, how did you answer a prayer that I prayed 7 days ago? And he said, hey, we got to call this guy. You got to talk to him. Maybe there's a partnership in the making. So a month later, I sat down for Mexican food with this man and I cast vision for the ministry, and he looked at me like I was a crazy person. You're 21 years old. Get lost, kid. Good luck. That's a big task. You want to give shoes to communities around the world and share Jesus? That's impossible. Like, good luck to you, man. Like, we've been around since the 70s. This is what we're doing. I'm like, okay, man. Like, here's my name. Here's my number. God bless you. Like, thanks for your time. I went back to college, and I was praying about moving home because I wasn't going to take what a man told me because I know what God told me. And so I'm praying, God, like, open a door for me to go back home to start the ministry. I don't know what this looks like, but I just want to give my life to your cause. 2 months later, this man calls me and he says, Dustin, the Jesus Film is so excited about our partnership with Feet That Move. Excuse me? Dude, what partnership are you talking about? You told me to get lost, good luck. And he goes, well, you see, we've been praying and, you know, we really feel like we need to come alongside of you and launch you into ministry. What's your next semester of school look like? Oh, well, I'm praying about moving home. Well, that's incredible, man. Do you think you could raise enough money to get about 350 shoes, and we're going to take you down to a community in the Yucatan with the Mayan people? You see, in Mexico, they speak Mayan in this little area, and we're launching this film, and it's amazing. And that was my first trip to Mexico. 4 years later, I now live there. Why? Because God used a man who didn't think he could be used. And so I just want to encourage us today. You might not think that your personality might not be a connector. It might not be someone that's constantly trying to connect people. But I want you to know that even if you don't think you can be used by God and connecting in relationships, but God's going to do that. A young guy's life was forever changed because a guy literally sat at my table who didn't think he could be used, and God used him. Why? Because he wants to use his children. The last point I have here this morning is he always develops something in us, and he will always come through. I love Hebrews 11. Being fulfilled in faith with a kingdom mindset to pass on the torch, to sow into your legacy. I love verse 39. It says, these were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would be made perfect. I've been praying for your church for the last couple months, and I feel like the Lord has been just showing me that this is a place of family. And I felt that as soon as I got here this morning. But I really believe that you as a church are going to be mothering and fathering not only the people here, but people. I can feel that personally through your ministry of just mothering and fathering, and just the blessing, even just to be just somewhat connected through Riley and in Mexico, and having her just come and serve and everything. I felt a kingdom connection through your church while we served. And I want you to know that God really is truly going to do an incredible work in the area of family here. I really believe it with all of my heart. And I want to stand here today and believe God for more with you this morning. And in the middle of worship, I began to pray, and I didn't have this in my notes or didn't really think. And Sean, do you mind coming up and just playing just kind of a little bit in the background? But I really wanted to spend, if it's all right this morning, I want to spend some time in prayer for your ministry, for this church. And in Mexico, we pray together. It's not a pastor praying, but we pray together as a family. And I feel like you're a family. and you're believing God for incredible things right now. You're believing God for a building. You're believing God for more people's lives to be touched and changed. And I just really feel like God wants us to pray. And this morning is not about feet that move or Mexico or testimonies, but it's, I really believe God's gonna provide, and not only financially, but in relationships, in visions and dreams. And I wanna believe for this with you this morning. And so I just wanna pray for you guys corporately, and I don't know how we wanna do this, but I would love to just invite all of you to just stand up, and I just wanna believe God for more. I wanna believe God for more for this city. I'm broken for this city just as much as I am for the Yucatan and Mexico. But until we get on our knees and we fall in love with a people, yes, God's not gonna, he listens to us as we become sons and daughters. He listens to us as we tap into the life source of him. And so I just want to invite us into just intercession and prayer for this new building. So God, we just ask you. We ask you for open doors and relationships in the city of Fort Worth for this building, God, for more relationships in the city, God, to connect this incredible church to what you're going to do here in this land, God. This land is dedicated to you. God, I pray that there's memories of things that have happened in this very room to expand the kingdom in this incredible church. I just pray for more families to become and restored and right relationship with you, God. I just pray for the Russell family, God, as they labor, as they've given their life for your cause. As they've given their life for this church, as they've given their finances, their resources. I just pray that you would open the heavens financially to provide for this building. I pray that you would speak to your children here in this church, God, with visions, God, an invitation to believe you for more. I just prophesy that there would be new relationships and new ministries that are birthed out of this church, not necessarily from people on staff, but people from the congregation of the Destiny Center, God. I thank you in advance for this. Thank you in advance for this, God. This is all for your glory. It is all for your glory, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this incredible church. Thank you for this incredible church, God. I thank you for this church as they look for going beyond, God, the missionaries that are in the field that they've been supporting, the people that they have relationships with, God. I thank you for the vision of more churches to be planted, for your gospel to be furthered in this city, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing in this church, God. We give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. I just pray for old thought patterns to be broken. Old thought patterns to be broken. I just pray for an expansion of mind, an expansion of resources, God, in the mind. Just like you gave Daniel wisdom and understanding and knowledge, God, I pray that you would open my brothers and sisters' minds here in this church for more skill sets in business, skill sets in education, skill sets for new ideas. Just like you've given me Spanish, God, to reach a people group, God, I pray that you would open up my brothers and sisters' minds to new capabilities, languages, and resources in the area of mind capacity, Father. I thank you for what you're doing here this morning, God. We worship you, Jesus. Worship you, Jesus. Worship you, Jesus. Worship you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Come on, let's give the Lord praise this morning.